Well, thank you all for coming to our December webinar for the Center for Subsurface Energy and the Environment. I'm Hugh Daigle, and I'll be introducing our speaker today. Just to give you a little bit of background on the center, we are a center made up of a diverse range of faculty with various backgrounds who investigate research areas related to energy and the environment in the subsurface. Here's a photo of all of us here. The research that goes on in the center covers, as I said, a very broad range of topics, including various subsurface applications from conventional oil and gas to geothermal, carbon storage, and gas hydrates. The technical disciplines that we cover are everything from standard reservoir engineering and formation evaluation to geology, geochemistry, computational sciences, and data analytics and machine learning, a very broad toolbox there. And speaking of tools, the tools that we use include everything from experimental work to simulation. We make specialized software. We build analytical models. And there's a lot of good stuff that happens. A lot of our research happens through our portfolio of industrial affiliates programs, which are listed here, which include research on conventional and unconventional rocks, production, digital technologies, and we're getting more into carbon utilization, storage and transportation and sustainability here. The monthly webinar series is intended to be an informative webinar driven by industry interests given by researchers and collaborators in the center here. Now, we have been doing these on the first Friday of every month, but starting in January 2022, I just want to give you a heads up that we'll be moving to having our webinars on the second Tuesday of each month at noon Central Time, and these will continue to be held via Microsoft Teams. We'll upload our webinars to our YouTube channel within a few days after the webinar. So if for some reason you can't make it, go ahead and check our YouTube channel a few days later, and you should be able to view the webinar. And just to give you a little bit of a teaser for what's coming up, on Tuesday, January 11th, Dr. Wen Song will give us a webinar on reservoir engineering approaches toward the energy transition, which should be very interesting. And then our next webinar in February will be on February the 8th, and that we'll have some information about coming soon. Now, during the webinar, I want to encourage you to please post your questions in the Q&A section of Microsoft Teams. We'll address those questions at the end, but you can type them in at any time. Just be sure to make sure you use that Q&A section. And now I'd like to introduce our speaker for today, who is Dr. Arvind Ravikumar, who is one of our newer faculty members here. He is a research associate professor who came to us most recently from the University of Harrisburg in Pennsylvania. And he's going to be talking about methane emissions and surviving the energy transition through mitigation of methane emissions. Just a little bit on Dr. Ravikumar's background. He holds a PhD in electrical engineering from Princeton University and a bachelor's and master's from the Biela Institute of Technology and Science. His research focuses on sustainable energy. He runs a sustainable energy development lab, and it's everything from technical, social, to policy solutions to the global energy sector through a combination of laboratory, computational, and field work. He focuses a lot on methane and liquefied natural gas, and that's what he's going to be talking to us about today. So without further ado, I'm going to hand it over to Dr. Ravikumar, and I hope you enjoy the webinar.
Excellent. Thank you, Hugh, for that generous introduction, and I'm extremely happy to be talking to all of you about one of the most exciting topics in the world of sustainability, as well as in the oil and gas industry, methane emissions. I mean, there's been so much going on just over the past 6 months that sometimes as an expert working on this every single day, it's hard for me to keep track of all the new developments in the space. So very excited to share some of that with you here and sort of talk a little bit about, you know, where are we going with respect to sustainability in the oil and gas world? And what does it mean for the oil and gas industry to be engaged in the process of the energy transition? As Hugh mentioned, please, if you have any questions at any time, put it in the Q&A box. I'll finish early, so we'll have a lot of time to discuss any questions that you might have. What I'll do over the next 30 to 35 minutes is give you a very broad overview of the kinds of things that we do here in my lab on methane emissions and the things that's going to be important going forward, looking at all the regulations and the interests coming down the pipeline over the next few years. So we are on the cusp of a transformation within the world of fossil fuels, specifically oil and gas. I mean, many of you might be skeptical, saying we have seen this before a couple decades ago and it didn't go anywhere. But this time it's different because it's not just one or two companies that are talking about net zero emissions or transitioning to new areas like hydrogen or geothermal. It is across sectors and countries. You have major oil and gas companies. If you just go to their websites right now, you'll see their different initiatives to different extents on how they are preparing for the energy transition. BP has net zero plans. Repsol has interim targets to achieve net zero emissions. Shell is going big on hydrogen. And a lot of companies talking about how can they reduce the emissions footprint of their operations. And it is not just limited to the oil and gas sector. There are players in every major sector that are announcing bold plans for significant emissions reductions. We have investors like institutional investors like Vanguard and BlackRock pledging to hit net zero. We have hard to abate industries such as airlines and the shipping industry talking about significantly reducing emissions and sustainable fuels. And we have countries, developing countries like India and China announcing their pledge to achieve net zero emissions somewhere around mid-century. And to sort of show the remarkable progress that we have made, I'm going to show this. Sort of, I found it very shocking, and maybe you do too. Global emissions are increasingly coming under net zero pledges. If you look at January 2022, just before everything was shut down because of the pandemic, we had 34% of global emissions with under some sort of net zero discussion, whether it's a legislated or a government position or something under discussion. Fast forward to April 2021, that increased from 34% to 57% with the net zero discussion. And I should add that 57% is right now about 66, because India announced their net zero target at the recently concluded COP26 in the United Kingdom. And so you can see on the right, the different countries that have some sort of net zero pledges or net zero discussions happening within their jurisdictions. So the question is, what's going to happen from where we are right now to where we need to go, which are these net zero targets? You know, getting to net zero does not necessarily mean the world will stop using fossil fuels, although it is likely to be substantially reduced or in a very different form. What the problem of addressing climate change is carbon emissions, not necessarily fossil fuels. So the question is, how do we reduce carbon emissions while also providing the energy that the world needs? And I think as sort of a leader in the oil and gas research world, our department, the Petroleum Engineering Department, is uniquely positioned to be academic leaders in this energy transformation. And part of the research that we do in my group, the Sustainable Energy Transition Lab, is basically answer this big black box in the middle that's shown with a question mark. We are currently in a place where 80% of our energy comes from fossil fuels, and we know we need to get to a place where we have to achieve about net zero emissions around 2050 and beyond. And so how do we get from where we are to where we will be? And that's sort of the central question around some of the research that we work on in our group. So what we do is we sort of combine field work, we do modeling and sort of techno-economic analysis to address sustainability questions in the oil and gas world. And the reason is simple. It is my belief that, you know, sustainability is not just about technology. Of course, you need the right technology to be able to reduce emissions. But more importantly, that technology resides in a world of economics and in a world of public policy. You need the right systems, you need the right costs and the right frameworks in place for any good technology to be able to usher in this era of net zero emissions. You can have the best technology in the world, but if you don't have the right economics or the right policies to support their deployment and scale up, that technology is not going to go anywhere. And so part of addressing this challenge of the energy transition is not only talk about and work on those technologies that will help us with the transition, but also understand how that technology fits into the global economic world and within the world of public policy. And so what we do is, we do fundamental science. We understand what, in this case, methane emissions that I'll be talking about in this talk, how methane emissions vary across the country, where are the methane emissions, how can we reduce them. We take that and put them into energy system models to understand, you know, what are the implications of methane emissions reductions on the broader oil and gas world. Where would be the most advantageous supply positions, where would be demand coming from, and how do those things evolve over time. And then we put all of this together to understand the economic and policy implications of the energy transition. And so this is more long-term. The third segment is more long-term, thinking about decarbonization pathways, for example, for the US LNG industry, or looking about looking at the futures of natural gas. How do we integrate renewable gas or hydrogen into existing energy infrastructure systems, and what are the cost implications of doing something like that? So this is sort of what we try to do, combine the science and the technology with the economics and policy of sustainability. So I'm going to start talking more specifically about methane emissions. It's a topic that I've been involved in for a number of years now, and that has become very important from a lot of different perspectives in more recent times. So for those of you who might be new to methane emissions, I'm going to start with three basic things you need to know about methane emissions to sort of understand the work that needs to be done to address this problem. So the first thing is, oil and gas methane emissions are distributions are highly skewed and exhibit significant geographic and temporal variations. What this means is that methane emissions in the Permian Basin will look very different from methane emissions in the Marcellus Basin. So the strategies you would need to address methane in the Permian Basin are not the same strategies you would need to address methane in the Marcellus Basin. Globally speaking, the emissions in the United States, the kind of methane emissions we have, the kind of sources that emit methane are kind of different in the United States versus in Europe. For example, in the US, we have small sites that might have a single well, maybe two wells. But in Europe and Central Asia, we have extremely large facilities that can have hundreds of wells on the same facility. So it looks very different depending on what geographic region of the world you're looking at. Second thing, and this is more hopeful, is that new technologies promise faster and cheaper methane emissions detection and quantification. And this is very important because with all the new technologies that are being developed, we can use what I call multi-scale measurements. For example, having a continuous monitor on your site, combining with aerial surveys to develop accurate inventory estimates of methane. And the last thing, and this is sort of the more exciting development in the policy world, is that the policy approaches themselves are entering a new era, both in the US and outside. EPA has come out with its new methane regulations, and one of the big changes EPA has done is that they are now allowing the use of some of these new technologies as a replacement for the conventional handheld cameras that most companies have had to use over the past few years. And so EPA is changing and sort of broadening its view in light of all these technological developments. There's going to be more transparency in operator level emissions, because now anyone can pay for a satellite to point at your facility and find out what your methane emissions are. And because of these technology improvements and improvements in quantifying emissions, we are seeing a huge explosion in concepts like responsible or certified gas, discussions of methane fee, et cetera. So I'll show you data to sort of back up these three different sort of basic information that we need to know about methane. The first one is methane emissions are dominated by what I call super emitters. Super emitters are basically very large methane emissions. And what we have seen time after time and study after study is that a very small number of emitters at your facility are responsible for a majority of the emissions. And we came up with a rule of thumb. We call it the 550 rule. What we're basically saying is, let's say you find 100 emitters at your operations. The top five of those emitters will be responsible for 50% of your emissions. The graph shows a data that we collected in Canada before the pandemic, so 2018, 2019, where we are plotting the emissions contribution on the y-axis, so the fraction of total emissions, as a function of the number of emitters, so the fraction of total emitters. And what we're finding is that they're all skewed to the left. And so what the dotted line shows, the black dotted line, is that the top 5% of emitters, so the highest emitting five leaks or five emitters that you have on your site, are responsible for a very large fraction of emissions, in this case ranging from about 40% to all the way up to 60% here. And this is true wherever we look, whether it's in the upstream segment, the midstream segment, or in the downstream segment. The thing is that there's significant uncertainty in the scale and location of oil and gas methane emissions around the world. We have a lot of data in the US and Canada on methane emissions, but we don't really have a lot of data from places like Russia or Central Asia that are also very large oil and gas producers. At the same time, even in the US, we are trying to understand where there's a gap between the EPA methane inventories and measurements. We have long known for some time that measurements always tend to demonstrate higher methane emissions than what is in official EPA inventories, and we have recently understood why that is. For example, this is a study we published in Nature recently where we're seeing that we compared measurements with inventories, and we're seeing that there are very specific categories of equipment where the EPA is underestimating emissions. And one example in this red box are tanks. EPA significantly underestimates methane emissions from tanks, but every time we go out and measure in the real world, whether it's in Marcellus or the Permian Basin, we see tanks are a huge source of methane emissions. So this is sort of understanding how emissions vary over space and time. And simultaneously, as we have learned a lot about methane emissions, new technologies have been developed that can help us monitor, estimate, and reduce upstream methane emissions. And so these are all pictures from different field campaigns. Some of them have been led by my group and some of them by others. So you have drones here, you have truck-based systems, you have aerial systems, and then you have satellites showing methane emissions in different ways. And all of these technologies are useful in different ways. Satellites can tell you emissions over a very large region and sort of quasi-continuously. And things like drones and aerial systems can give you more precise information about where those emissions are coming from and generally have a lower detection limits. And then on the policy side, we have this proliferation of responsible or certified gas frameworks because of the increased focus on addressing methane emissions. And so there's the Global Methane Pledge that some of you might have heard about to reduce methane emissions by 30% by 2030. 30% of all methane emissions, so a significant chunk of that is going to come from oil and gas methane emissions. And there are, you know, there are investor and public and consumer activism that are forcing companies to take steps to address the carbon and methane emissions. So the carrot part of the problem is having, for example, higher premiums for supply chains with certified low emissions. And the stick part of it is, of course, we've seen the French companies cancel contracts with Permian operators because of, allegedly because of high methane leakage and flaring. That's what they said publicly. We don't know exactly why they actually canceled contracts. And because of this, we are seeing a proliferation of certification frameworks to meet demand for low emissions fuels. For example, there's the MIQ framework with a grading system of A through F for suppliers. So grade A means you have certain low emissions and grade F means you do not have low emissions. But I'm very concerned about this proliferation of frameworks because based on the technologies, based on the information that we know about measurements, is that many of these approaches to certification have not been validated. They've been proposed, but there's been no field validation of these certifications and whether a company that's given the grade A actually has emissions that are much lower than a company that gets grade B, for example. And personally, as of today, I don't think many of these certification frameworks are capable of delivering on their claims. Of course, this doesn't mean that this will change, this will not change in the future, but at this moment, there's not been any robust scientific validation of any of these publicly available frameworks. So, 5 years in methane research, technology, and policy development is going to look like? The first thing is we still have quite a bit to understand what methane emissions look like and closing gaps between the inventory and measurements. And so we are starting to do what I said about multi-scale measurements. So not just talking about which technology is going to be most effective for me, but what combination of technologies is going to give me the right answer so I can better update my inventories? And of course, we also want to understand how emissions vary over time. Emissions are not constant. Emissions often occur randomly and for short durations. So how do we find those short duration and intermittent methane emissions? That's sort of the science side. We have to improve our understanding. Then we have the technology side. Of course, we have to leverage developments in technologies like drones for cost-effective detection and estimation of emissions. And this is sort of giving way to a global independent monitoring system. EDF is sending a satellite called Methane Sat in the next couple of years, and they have said that the data will be publicly available. There are currently many satellites right now in orbit by private companies who operate it as a service. So for example, the EPA or anyone could pay them to point at a facility and estimate what the methane emissions are. The satellite technology in particular is not as advanced to talk about facility level emissions, but they're quickly getting there very soon. And the last thing is we need work on some of these new policy frameworks aided by advances in our understanding of methane, as well as new technologies that can more effectively measure them. So questions like, what type of measurements are needed for gas certification programs? And can we develop intensity metrics for individual supply chains? So not asking questions like, what are methane emissions from the Permian Basin, but asking questions like, for the gas that comes into my house, from the well to the pipeline to the compressor station to the distribution system, what is the methane intensity for that specific supply chain? So each individual supply chain will have its own methane emissions estimate. And in a world where we start having responsible gas frameworks and methane fees, then we can start discriminating between companies that have a better handle on methane versus companies that do not. So what do we do to improve our understanding of methane emissions? So I'm going to give an example of one study we are in fact currently doing as I speak, so very preliminary and new data. We are closing gaps in methane emissions measurement. So this is a project where we are literally going to every single compressor station, midstream compressor station in New York State and measuring methane emissions. So this graph basically shows you all the compressor stations in New York. The blue ones are transmission stations, the yellow ones are storage, and there are a couple of gathering and boosting stations as well. What we found from the study is that the actual emissions are about 50% lower than the EPA or state inventories. I mean, normally measurements always find emissions that are higher than inventory estimates, but in this case, we are finding about 50% lower. And there are very good reasons for that. Typically, states do not have the capacity to do their own measurements, so they usually use EPA data and downscale it to their state or other proxy data. But this is the first time, at least in New York State, we have actually gone and measured them, and we are finding results that are different from prior assumptions. So I'm going to show some nice pictures now. So we used scientific aviation, who have been doing these sort of research studies for quite a bit. So we put methane measuring instruments on the plane and we fly them around facilities in concentric circles like that's shown here. So the blue dots are methane measurements. So on the upwind side, there's no methane, so it's all dark blue, so which is just background methane. But on the downwind side, you see a lot of colored dots, yellows and blues and reds and maroons, where they correspond to peaks in methane concentration. So we do this for all stations and estimate what the methane emissions are coming from the facility that's within this circular pattern. And we also have other instruments on board. For example, we have an OGA camera on board that can help us correlate what we're measuring from the air with what's happening on the ground. So this is a compressor station, and you can see four different stacks, exhaust stacks of these compressors. And if you look at it through an infrared camera, this is what you'll see. So you'll see that three of the stacks are lit, one of them is not. So at the time we were measuring at the site, three of the turbines were operating and one of them was not. And so we can correlate the emissions with the exact engine load and exact operations on the ground and not just attribute to a facility. And so it helps us understand how changes on the ground affects the methane emissions that we're observing from the air. And what we found from this study is that, again, highly skewed distributions. So this is a graph that shows the fraction of total emissions from each site. as a function of the methane emission rate. And what we found is that 90% of emissions are coming from sites that emit more than 80 kilograms per hour. That's about 18,000 metric tons of CO2e, still below the reporting threshold. But what you can see clearly that over 90% of emissions are coming from sites with larger emissions. And the most important part is the top 10% of the sites. So if you take the 10 sites that are the highest emitting across New York State, together they contribute to 50% of total emissions. And so it shows how skewed emissions are. So all you have to do to address emissions is to see, understand where the emissions at these high emitting sites are coming from and how to mitigate those emissions. That's going to give you a significant reduction in emissions. So back to my original statement of, you know, why we think New York State emissions are actually 50% lower than the state inventory estimates is because of the kinds of compressor stations that we have. Broadly speaking, there are two types. There are compressor stations with engines that run on engines and compressor stations that run on turbines. And what we find is that engines emit a lot more methane than turbines. So here's a graph of methane flux as a function of the operational horsepower of the compressor stations. So the purple line are the engine stations and the blue line is the turbines. So a couple of things, right? So the purple ones, stations that have engines, have higher methane emissions and lower operational horsepower. And the stations that have turbines have higher operational horsepower and lower emissions. So sites that are running on turbines have lower methane emissions than sites that are running on engines. And because New York State inventory had downscaled the EPA inventory, that assumed a combination of turbines versus engines that was similar to what was in the EPA inventory. But what we found was that it was different. New York State had more turbines than they had engines, and therefore the emissions from New York State were lower than the emissions that one would estimate from EPA estimates, because EPA's fraction of turbine versus engine is different for national average versus for New York State. There are a couple of other reasons also why the emissions were lower, but this sort of tells you how direct measurements help us improve our understanding of what the emissions are and how they are distributed across states. We can assume that compressor station measurements done in, say, in Texas can be translated to compressor station emissions done in New York State. So that's about how we are improving science with direct measurements. The second thing is sort of very closely related to that is how are new technologies helping us to better understand methane emissions and estimate emissions? So the first question is, there are like so many of these new technologies out there. How do we evaluate them? And the goal is to consistently and fairly compare new methane detection technologies so that operators and regulators can use those tests and assessments of performance to choose whatever technology is best for them. This is especially important now because EPA is actually allowing operators to use some of these new technologies in as part of compliance with their methane regulations. So here are pictures from two tests that we ran. One was a mobile monitoring challenge about 3 years ago in Colorado and California. The other one was the Alberta methane field challenge in Canada, where we basically took about 10 technologies each of those times and tested them at oil and gas facilities. There are currently several trials that are ongoing right now in the midstream segment with the New York State that we are working with some operators there to test new technologies. There's also a Department of Energy study right now testing new technologies at different basins across the country. So if you're interested in testing new technologies and you're trying to get your feet wet with some of these new systems, send me a note and we can chat more and I can tell you more about what kind of studies are happening and how you could get the technologies you're interested in tested at one of these as part of one of these projects. So what does testing tell us? It tells us about the technology and specifically looking at the false positivity rate. What is their detection threshold? Can they see intermittent emissions? What is their quantification accuracy? And control testing helps us evaluate all of these fundamental technology performance parameters. So this is a technology developed by Ball Aerospace. It's an aerial imaging system. So what you're seeing is a controlled methane release that we did on the ground and they detected while flying over the site. And with several such measurements. We can talk about what their false positivity rates and true positivity rates. So in this case, the first bar is when we had leaks. About 75% of the time, they correctly identified that there was a leak, and about 25% of the time, they did not identify even when there was a leak. So that's a false negative rate, and the average false negative emission rate was about 190 scf. So for this aerial technology, your detection limit is somewhat under around 200 standard cubic feet per hour, because if it's less than that and your wind conditions are not very good, the technology might not see that. And so what we get here are something called as detection probability curves. And the reason the detection probability curves is important is because it tells you what kind of methane leaks would a technology see. So for this technology, there's a 50% chance that it'll see a leak as long as it's about the second bar, around 200 standard cubic feet per hour. If your leak is, say, 1,000 scf, it's definitely going to see it. Or on the other hand, if your leak is, say, 20 scf, this technology will probably not see it. So if you know that the emissions at your facility are of the order of 20 or 40 scf, then you cannot use this technology. You need a different technology to detect your methane emissions. But if your major emissions are things like large emissions from a stuck dump valve or an unlit flare, which is a huge methane vent, then you could potentially just use a satellite and see what your emissions are. So choosing the right technology depends on what kind of emissions you have at your site. But technology is not, it's just one part of methane mitigation. So there's a difference between technology performance and LDAP program effectiveness. So sort of a cartoon example, I'm going to tell you the difference in this way. So when I talk about technology performance, the question I'm asking is, can a new technology X on a platform Y detect methane emissions? This is what we do by doing all of these testings at control test sites and oil and gas facilities. But translating that into an LDAP program is a fundamentally different question. So now the question really is, can an LDAR program, LDAR stands for leak detection and repair, so can an LDAR program with technology X, platform Y, surveying Z times per year in basin B under these weather conditions and repair rules, reduce emissions by 50%? And this sort of nicely explains the difference between, you know, understanding how a technology works versus understanding how a technology can help with complying with an LDAR program. For the first part, we need direct testing of these technologies. For the second part, we need modeling. We need to be able to model the policy, the leak detection repair program, with these new technologies. And so that is what we do. One of the things we have developed in the group is the FEAST model. FEAST stands for the Fugitive Emissions Abatement Simulation Tool. And it basically does that. It provides a consistent platform to compare different leak detection technologies and emissions reduction programs. So as inputs, these models take the different technologies that you want to test. So planes, drones, trucks, satellites, and the data we collect from testing them. It also takes an emission scenario. So what kind of facilities do you have? Are these single well sites or are the large multi-well sites? Are you an upstream operator or a midstream operator? Do you have compressor stations in your facilities, in your assets? So it takes in the emissions data and, of course, the LDAR program, which is sort of the policy specifics of what the mitigation protocol looks like. So things like survey frequency, policy timeline, repair protocols. And what we get from this model is talk about technology equivalence, which is basically asking the question of, you know, if I want to replace, say, quarterly LDAR surveys with the OJ camera, as EPA is requiring, with a plane-based technology, how many times should I survey that with that technology to achieve the same emissions reductions? We can talk about costs and benefits, as well as long-term emissions reductions with using some of these new technologies. I'm not going to go into details of the results, but I'm going to give an example of what this looks like. So in this case, it's a comparison between a standard optical gas imaging survey, which is the handheld camera, and an aerial survey. So you fly over a plane, a flyover your sites with the plane tags sites that have high methane emissions, and then you send someone to go and fix emissions at those sites tagged by the plane. So what you're seeing here on the x-axis is survey frequencies. So how many times you do the leak detection survey, and on the y-axis, you are looking at fugitive emissions reductions, which is how much methane you reduce. The orange curve is the LDAR program with the OJ camera, so the traditional EPA method. So as you increase survey frequency, your emissions reductions also increases, because you now have, if you do it twice a year compared to once a year, on average, leaks are emitting only for 6 months as opposed to 12 months between two different surveys. So your mitigation increases, and the black dots are what EPA thinks emissions reductions are going to be. It's broadly similar to what we observe in our modeling. But if you look at a plane survey, again, the same thing, but you do the survey with a plane instead of the OJ camera, you can also see emissions reductions in the purple curve increase as you increase the number of surveys per year. But it is lower than the camera survey, because planes have a much higher detection threshold than cameras. Cameras can see, for example, a leak as small as 10 standard cubic feet per hour. A plane might not. It might only start seeing leaks if it's about 100 standard cubic feet per hour. So all the leaks between 10 and 100 might not be seen by the plane and will be seen by the OGI camera, and therefore will have a higher emission reductions. So the question is not, you know, is a plane better than the OJ camera? The question is, what should I do with a plane to get the same emissions reductions? That's what the dotted lines are. So if you want, say, 40% emissions reductions, you can either do a survey once a year with the OJ camera, or you can do a plane survey that's three times a year. And just because you are doing more surveys with a plane does not necessarily mean it's going to be more expensive. For example, typically the OGA survey in the US, the orange curve, costs about $600 a site. The plane survey costs about $100 a site. So $600 a site for one survey, for one site. For the plane, even if you have to do three surveys, that's only $300 for that site. So you're getting the same emissions reductions, but now the cost is 50% lower. And so you can still have higher frequent surveys, you can reduce emissions, and still lower costs because new technologies are faster. And the choice of this technology depends on various factors. The first one is application. Do you want to just detect your methane emissions, or do you also want to quantify them? Because in the universe of new technologies, some technologies are good only for detection, but some technologies are good for both detection and quantification. And depending on your goal, you might want to choose one or the other. It depends on geography. We already discussed that. Emissions in the Permian Basin is not the same as emissions in the Marcellus Basin. High winds affect technologies differently. Cloud cover makes satellites less useful. So if you're a Canadian operator, satellites are not going to be very useful for you. And if you have extended winter months and extensive snow cover on the ground, some imaging technologies might not work. So technologies you use in North Dakota will not be the same technologies you might want to use in the Permian Basin. And the last thing is, the technology also depends on the emissions at a facility. So we have seen huge differences between dry gas operations versus wet gas operations. Whether your sites have more vented emissions or more fugitive emissions, or in some cases, whether your sites have continuous emissions versus intermittent high volume events. So you need technologies if the majority of your emissions on your site are coming from intermittent events, such as, say, water tanks, produced water tanks that are uncontrolled. And so you'll have only methane emissions when the separator dumps into those tanks. So those are intermittent, or when an upset condition occurs at your facility. And we can use models. In this example, we are using machine learning models to improve the sustainability of operations and reduce cost of methane mitigation. Right now, LDAP programs work by saying, okay, just randomly go visit all your sites, do the surveys, and fix all the methane leaks you find. That's what we're showing here, how much of the emissions fractions we reduce on the y-axis, and the number of days it takes. This is the standard OGI-based survey. So the gray ones are the standard one where you randomly survey your sites. But we developed a sort of a very basic machine learning model, taking in all the data that we could find about those sites, and asked the machine learning model to predict the order in which you have to survey. So presumably, if the model works, it'll tell you sites that are likely to have high emissions to be surveyed first. And that's what we find. In the red curve that you see here, we get to 50% emissions reductions on day 7 versus in the random model that we currently do, we only achieved that 50% by day 12. So there are some newer advances in data science that could help us think about even reducing the costs of emissions reductions further. And the last section and the last 5 minutes of my talk is going to focus on the new policy frameworks. How does the new science we are learning and the new technologies that are being developed help achieve some of the new policy paradigms that are being discussed to address methane emissions? And I'm going to focus mostly on the responsible gas certification frameworks, because that is something that's gaining ground both in the US as well as in the European Union. So there are three key requirements for an effective responsible gas framework. The first one is accurate inventory development. You can only reduce that which you count. So you have to verify using measurements that your inventory is not an underestimate. And this has been an issue that we have known for some time. So every responsible gasification framework has to be backed up by measurements and not just be based on paper inventory estimates. You also need long-term multi-scale measurements. And this is because you want to measure emissions that are intermittent. If you're only doing surveys twice a year or three times a year, it is highly likely that you're not going to find some of those large emission events that sometimes happen only for, say, 12 hours. We were at a site very recently in Pennsylvania where there was an issue of a stuck dump valve, which means methane emissions were just going all the way. All the entire production was just being emitted into the atmosphere. That event happened only for 12 hours. And yet it was a very significant methane emission release. And we had a sensor on the site that detected that methane emission. But if you didn't have it and you weren't doing a survey when that event happened, you wouldn't know about it. But we must know how frequently, what is the frequency of such events to be able to better estimate methane emissions. And it's especially important if you're going to be giving grades to operators on their performance, you need to know exactly what their methane emissions have been. And it has to be independently verified. It should go beyond check the box exercises on operational practices. Ideally, you would want parallel validation of multiple data sets. So you take the inventory from the company, you have the measurement data, and you have event logs on what happened at the site, and make sure they all agree with each other. All right, so what are the key features of methane emissions that are critical to develop these low leakage supply chains? So we know that they vary widely across operators, basins, and countries. We know that there are super emitters, which we just learned. And they're often short duration events. They are intermittent and unpredictable. So we need to know about questions like how often do they occur, how much do they emit? And conventional emissions inventory methods are underestimating emissions, largely because they don't account for the super emitters or their time varying nature. And one way to address this, and I think we are doing this with Chenier, there was a public announcement a couple of months ago, is how can we leverage multi-scale measurements to develop robust science-based certified gas frameworks? So there are different scales of measurements, right? You can do direct on-site survey, that's the level zero. Then you have drones that can help you find emissions on specific inventory, so it can help you verify inventory estimates for different equipment. Then we have aerial surveys, that's level two, which is fast repeat measurements of surveys to quantify emissions. And then the reason the fast is important is because you have to know what the emissions are over a very large number of assets. To reduce your uncertainty, you can either measure one site 100 times, or you can measure 100 sites one time. And to be able to do that, to be able to do a large number of measurements, you need technologies that have the right resolution, but are also fast. And I think aerial technologies are best suited for that. And then instead of level three, the most highest top-down level are satellite measurements. This can help you do long-term monitoring of your asset portfolios. Doesn't mean you need to do all of these levels all the time, but this sort of tells you how different levels of measurement can get you different kinds of information. And so depending on your goals, whether it's certified gas frameworks or identifying your super emitters or validating your inventories, you might want to choose the right combination of technologies to be able to get that data. And so I'm going to give you three guideposts on what you should be looking out for when someone pitches you on certified gas frameworks or talking about how do we ensure that emissions are what we say they are. So the first one is they have to deliver on claims of certifying low emission. So the thing to look out for is artificial precision. Here's a simple example. Let's say a company gets grade A if their leakage is below 0.05%, or they get grade B if their leakage is between 0.05 and 0.1%. And here's an example of methane emissions that was measured in a very recent study by satellites. And I want you to pay attention to the error bars. The error bars are pretty significant, about 20-30%. And in the world of methane quantification, that's reasonable, that's good. That's a good error. But the problem is when you have 30% quantification error, you cannot reliably distinguish between 0.05% and 0.1%. And so if you're going to give grades to companies based on a 0.05% difference in methane emissions, that won't work because you don't have the technologies to be able to give you that level of precision. So you have to be careful about looking at or talking about artificial precisions. Now, there are ways to reduce them. If you measure the site 100 different times, you can reduce your uncertainty. But if you're going to talk about 0.05% precision, then that needs to be combined with significant measurements to reduce, to get you the right level of precision. The second thing you want to be looking out for is infrequent or single technology measurements to estimate emissions. So this is an example of measurements from compressor stations that we collected of 8 stations. We went back to those 8 stations every single day for a week. So every gray dot is 1 day of measurement. And you can see variations, especially for site number 2. On one day, it was 50 kilograms per hour. On a different day, it was 300 kilograms per hour. For site 1, on one day, it was about 180 kilograms per hour. On site on day 4, it was about 500 kilograms per hour. So it varies quite a bit on a daily basis. And so if you're just doing very infrequent measurement, that's not going to cut it to certify low emissions. So you, because emissions vary so frequently, you want more frequent measurements so that these intermittent measurements will not miss these intermittent super emitter events. And the last thing is verification. Verification schemes that do not reconcile the measurements, inventory, and event logs. I showed this graph before where we found discrepancy in tank emissions between EPA inventories and actual measurements. And this is something that should be avoided when we talk about certified gas frameworks. And so effective verification is going to require independent experts who can evaluate if the company inventory accurately reflects measurements and event logs. And maybe there's role for machine learning and other data, advanced data science tools to be able to do this, but this is a critical component of certifying low emission supply chains. So what comes next? Sustainability, I think, is going to be the defining theme of the next 30 years. So we're going to see major oil and gas companies, governments, businesses, and investors needing experts to fill growing needs in science, engineering, and policy associated with sustainability. Methane emissions in the oil and gas sector is poised for a remarkable growth in innovation, both in terms of technology as well as in terms of policy, largely because it is a low-hanging fruit to reduce emissions, and it can help you differentiate operators in countries from others by addressing their methane challenge. In all these technical discussions, we forget how big of an issue methane is. For example, if global energy sector methane emissions were a country of its own, it would be the third largest emitter in the world, next only to China and the United States. So it is a big challenge, and we do have the technologies and the solutions for addressing it. So it's going to be the low-hanging fruit to address them quickly. And we're going to do multi-scale measurements to fully characterize them. So you're going to put continuous monitoring systems on your site that can constantly monitor your site and tell you when there's a big emission, something goes wrong, so you can come out and fix it. And you'll supplement that with other technologies to quantify emissions from other sources. And the last thing is the technology and policy moving parallel will bring greater global transparency and usher in an era of intensity-based gas trading frameworks. I think this is where everyone's headed. And all of the new technologies that are being developed can help improve inventory estimates for fee-based regimes and certifications. But as I said recently, we do need to exercise caution evaluating responsible gas claims by asking the questions on whether they are doing the right measurements and whether they are independent estimates. But all of the technologies and the science that we're developing will help us do exactly that over the next few years. And we're going to see a remarkable change globally on how we talk about methane emissions and how we approach our issue of addressing methane emissions. With that, I'm going to stop and see if folks have questions. All right, so this question is asking about, have you looked into methane emissions from abandoned wells? It's a hot topic in the infrastructure regrowable. That's definitely true. I have not personally looked at methane emissions from abandoned wells. I do have colleagues that I work with who are doing these measurements of abandoned wells. My own perspective is that it is an important issue because of agency considerations. There's no one technically responsible for plugging these abandoned wells, and especially in places like Pennsylvania, we don't even know where many of these abandoned wells are. So it's a huge, sort of a job creation program to find these abandoned wells and plug them all across the country. It's going to be a multi-year effort, and I think that's actually helpful to address this problem, long-standing problem. That said, I do not think methane emissions from abandoned wells is a big part of the methane emissions challenge. If you look at distribution of methane emissions from the supply chain, production, processing, transmission, and distribution take up over 95% of all methane emissions, and the total contribution of methane emissions from abandoned wells is relatively small. So from a methane emissions perspective, it's not as big of an issue, but from a jobs perspective and an environmental liability and environmental degradation perspective, it is a hugely important problem that needs to be addressed. The next question is there a similar system for CO2 emissions detection? Yes, there are a lot of different technologies for CO2 emissions detection, but the challenge is fundamentally different for CO2 than it is for methane. Methane, the background concentration is about 1.8 ppm, and you are trying to find methane leakage enhancements over that. For CO2, the background concentration is about over 400 ppm, and you have to detect small changes about that. So it is a technically different challenge, but there are strategies. There are sensor networks that are being tested right now, especially to monitor methane emissions from long-term geologic storage. As we talk more and more about carbon capture and sequestration, being able to monitor methane emissions, monitor carbon emissions from leaking from these reservoirs is going to be a critical aspect of technology advancements to support CCS. Okay, why is the focus on percent reductions instead of absolute quantity reductions? This is a very good question. So why a percent reduction and not an absolute standard? I think that's a great question because until recently, we didn't have the technologies that can actually quantify methane emissions and emissions intensity effectively. But now that's changing. We are having new technology. So now there is room to move from a percentage reduction basis. So moving from a percentage reduction basis to an intensity-based basis. The percentage reduction is easier because you can have high uncertainty or quantification, but as long as you use the same technology initially and at the end of your policy period, you can compare relative changes, and so percentages are attractive for that. But now the technologies are improving. I think we'll quickly see companies and governments moving towards an intensity-based or performance standard-based regulations. All right, is there any applicability for landfill sites? Yes, there is. Many scientists are conducting similar studies for methane emissions from landfills. Is there a leakage rate at which natural gas loses its climate benefits over coal for power generation? Do you believe the US is currently below the leakage rate? Yes, there is a leakage rate below which natural gas becomes worse than coal, but it's usually fairly high. It's close to 8-9% or something like that, depends on the metric, but it's usually very high. And US on average is definitely lower than that from the preponderance of evidence from methane emission studies across different oil and gas basins. There might be pockets of US basins and US oil and gas production where that equation might be more problematic. For example, recent studies in the Permian Basin show emissions as high as 9%. which is something we definitely look into, and we know the Permian Basin has a methane problem, but on average, U.S. methane leakage is about 2.3%, which is far lower than what you would need to sort of override the benefits of natural gas for over coal in methane emissions. Do you have an estimate of methane emissions naturally occurring, such as permafrost, compared to human methane emissions now and expected in the future? I don't have the right numbers, but there are definitely studies looking at what are geologic sources, such as geologic seepage, permafrost thaw, versus anthropogenic or man-made sources like agriculture and landfill and oil and gas. I think the rough split is 40% from natural sources and 60% methane emissions from man-made sources globally, but you should check on that. And that information is easily available on the EPA website, actually. And there's a project called the Global Methane Project that does inventories of global methane emissions from all sources every 2 years, and they also have updates on what are the different components of methane emissions. Great question. I'm originally a laser physicist, so this is the perfect question for me. Thank you for asking. Different wavelengths detect methane. The best wavelengths are in the mid-infrared region, 3.2 to 3.4 micrometers, but it is very challenging to make electronics and optics in that wavelength range. So the optical gas imaging, the FLIR cameras use that range. That's why it costs $100,000 a camera. Many of the laser systems that are being developed with these plane sensors and drone sensors, they use near-infrared, 1.2 to 1.6 micrometers. Less sensitive for methane, but much cheaper and much easier due to the electronics, so it's become more attractive than the mid-infrared. What are organizations leading the effort here? I'm assuming the effort refers to methane emissions reductions. A lot of them, a lot of players are involved. Oil and gas companies are directly involved in many of these studies and are actively deploying these technologies to their facilities. There are NGOs pushing for strong methane emissions, and there are regulations coming from governments, both state, federal, and global, elsewhere outside the United States, that are pushing to address methane emissions from oil and gas operations. And this is, in fact, one of the very few things that almost everyone agrees on that they should address. And I think that's a good sign of things to come in the field of methane. I gave a lot of information on methane emissions in the oil and gas world. If you have any questions or comments, just reach out to me via email. We can discuss more and some of the newer projects that we are currently involved with.
Okay, well, thank you all again for coming to our December webinar. Thank you to Dr. Ravi Kumar for a very interesting presentation and interesting discussion at the end. And I'd again like to remind you that starting next month in January, our webinars will be on the second Tuesday of each month. So please join us on January 11th for Dr. Song's webinar, where we will continue to investigate issues related to the energy transition. Thanks, and enjoy the rest of your day.